pleasure to be able to share a message with you from this week's parsha, Parshat Bamidbar, the very first parsha in the book of Numbers. There's so much in life I don't understand. There's so many lessons I'm supposed to have gleaned over the course of my life's experience that I still haven't gotten yet. In fact, there are some moments that will never be understandable. I can't wait till I have an opportunity to meet God face to face. And I get to ask all of those questions that have been on my mind all these years. I pray that we all have that opportunity at some point. And if it's true of life in general, it's true also of the specific texts in which we encounter. There are moments in the Talmud and in the Mishnah and in the Midrash and in the Torah itself that I have encountered. I simply don't understand what I was supposed to learn. And sometimes I have great teachers who explain the texts to me, but then sometimes texts are simply inexplicable. We don't know what the lesson is we're supposed to learn. And there are certain moments within the text in which our rabbis are equally dumbfounded. In fact, they're so dumbfounded that what they have done is they placed a marker on the page in order to be able to say, we're going to go back. And in Yimot HaMashiach, in a messianic age, when we have an opportunity to meet God face to face, we're going to go back to these texts and we're going to say, I dog-eared that page so that we would have an opportunity to talk about what's going on there because I simply don't understand it. And this week's parsha has one of those moments. Amidst the census that Moses and Aaron are taking, there are these dots that appear in the 39th verse of chapter 3. These dots appear over Aaron's name. The text says that Moses and Aaron embarked on a census of the Jewish people and they arrived at a number of 22,000 men who were of age of service in the military. This census was in order to make sure that they were well prepared in case a war were to break out. And the Midrash says that those dots that appear over Aaron's name were an indication that Aaron wasn't counted in that group. But still, the text doesn't make much sense until the Midrash alerts us to the fact that there are other moments in the Torah in which dots appear over the words. One of those moments is when Jacob and Esau embrace. After years of not seeing each other, Jacob and Esau come together. And the text says, Vayishakehu, and they kissed each other, they embraced. And the same dots that appear here. And so it's from that that I learn a lesson about these dots that appear here. So let me put it in context for you. Jacob and Esau haven't seen each other for many decades. Their lives have grown apart both geographically and emotionally. They come together and it is a difficult moment in which they're incredibly joyful about being reunited, but they're also somewhat apprehensive, not knowing what to expect from the other. They're also incredibly sad about the years they have lost. It is an emotion-filled moment in which they are overrun by lots of different feelings. They're sad and they're happy. They're anxious and they're confident. All at the same time, you see, that's how emotions work. They're not easy to separate out and they're not specific and linear in that way. I believe that's exactly what's going on here with Aaron, and that's why there are dots above his name. You can imagine, at the beginning of the parsha, there are names recalled, one after another, people who made significant contributions to each tribe. And of course, absent from that list are the two sons of Aaron who died tragically in that accident in the tabernacle. In fact, they are recalled at the beginning of chapter 3. So we arrive at this moment, and you can imagine the mixed emotions that Aaron is feeling. He's elated that the Jewish people have grown so strong and powerful. He's grateful for the two sons that continue to work alongside him in the service in the tabernacle. But he's also incredibly sad about the death of his two sons. When Moses and Aaron encounter each other for the first time after the death of Nadab and Avihu, after the death of Aaron's two sons, Moses' two nephews, Aaron has no response. He becomes silent. Vayidom Aharon, says the text. He doesn't utter a word. In fact, there is a silence about him that is unnerving. Why doesn't he emote? Why doesn't he scream out in anger? Why doesn't he cry? And that's, unfortunately, the way emotions work. They don't come out in the moments where you expect them most. It's sometimes a quiet moment later, a smell, a vision, a touch that reminds us of something that we loved and we lost. That is what happens here. And I believe that the dots on the page are the empathetic splatterings of a scribe who sheds a tear at this moment in understanding the loss that Aaron must have felt. The dots, I believe, appear on this page because a tear dropped from the Sofer's eye and it splattered, making these dots above the page and above Aaron's name, indicating the incredible sadness that Aaron must have felt and hopefully the capacity for him to shed a tear. Grief is difficult, it's painful. Loss is sometimes hard to overcome. The loss of a child is certainly something that is something we can never understand. But I believe that we're given a moment of healing here in this week's parsha as Aaron sheds a tear. We should understand that tears have a healing capacity, that it's good to cry, that you can't keep it bottled up inside, and that tears allow us that opportunity to begin the grieving process. They allow us to continue to live. They allow us to continue to feel. So I pray that is our blessing for the coming week. I pray that we are all given moments of great joy and triumph and celebratory moments. But I also pray that in those sad moments that we're given the gift of tears, the gift that allows us to find some healing and certainly an expression of the sadness that we feel in our lives. We can empathize and sympathize with Aaron, who has lost two children. We recognize the bounty that we have in our lives, but that doesn't take away from the sadness, nor do we have to separate them into component parts. I pray that we're all blessed with great joy and laughter, but also that in the sadness that we find great tears and consolation.